knows a lot about the science stuff. Professor Dave Explains.
We just examined some concepts in population ecology, which, as we recall, pertains to populations or groups of organisms of a particular species. But things become much more complicated when looking at communities. An ecological community is a group of potentially interacting species living in the same location. Communities are bound together by a shared environment and network of influence. A forest, for example, is not just trees and plants on the forest floor, but also the animals that call the forest home, and the bacteria and fungi hanging out in the soil through which the trees and plants grow and sustain their roots. An understanding of community structure is vital in predicting the effects of decline in or extinction of species. Community structure is the ecologist's term for indicating which organisms are present in a given environment, in what numbers, and how they relate to one another. Dynamics pertain to how these communities change over time. Often this is following environmental disturbances like volcanoes, earthquakes, fires, and climate change. Communities with a relatively constant number of species are said to be at equilibrium. The equilibrium is dynamic, with species identities and relationships changing over time, but maintaining relatively constant numbers. Following a disturbance, the community may or may not return to the equilibrium state. Understanding structure and dynamics better enables ecologists to manage ecosystems more effectively. Within ecological webs, species interactions include a number of two-way interactions, some of which we've already covered, like mutualism, competition, and predation. There's another, called commensalism, which is an association between two organisms in which one benefits and the other derives neither benefit nor harm. A few examples of this include tree frogs using plants as protection, suckerfish living on sharks for protection, and expelled golden jackals trailing tigers to feed on the remains of its kill. Because of the many complex linkages among species in a food web, changes to one species can have far-reaching effects. Resource partitioning is the division of limited resources by species to help avoid competition in an ecological niche. In any environment, organisms will compete for limited resources, so organisms and different species have to find ways to coexist with one another. Another way to think of this is as a process of natural selection that forces competitors to use resources differently to avoid competition between species, thus allowing for coexistence. An example of this is different species of birds feeding on insects on different parts of the tree. Some birds go for insects on the tree trunk, others on the tree branches. This reduces competition and ensures longer-term survival for both species of birds. Succession describes the sequential appearance and disappearance of species in a community over time, after a severe disturbance. In primary succession, newly exposed or newly formed rock gets colonized by living organisms. An example of this is formation of new lava on the island of Hawaii. Succulent plants take root first, thus they become the pioneer species and set the stage for other species. In secondary succession, part of an ecosystem is disturbed, say due to a wildfire, and remnants of the previous community remain. A hybrid ecosystem then emerges. In both cases, there is a sequential change in species until a more or less permanent community develops. The current condition of an ecological system is its state. It's possible to occupy more than one state for a given set of environmental conditions. Which alternative state is occupied depends on the history of the system and the perturbations it has been exposed to. Alternative states are stable when they are maintained following further small perturbations. A shift from healthy coral reef communities to macroalgae is indicative of a changing climate, a shift in temperatures in the ocean water. This is an alternative state which eventually stabilizes in its new normal. It's important to observe and understand these states in order to predict what might happen in the future. Just knowing habitat conditions is not good enough if it is possible that two states might persist there. We also need to know if a state change will be easily reversed or not, and how this might best be achieved if the outcome is an undesirable one. Ecologists must understand the dynamics of systems to avoid surprising catastrophic changes that are difficult to recover from. Moving on from community ecology, landscape ecology is the study of the pattern and interaction between ecosystems within a region of interest, and the way the interactions affect ecological processes, especially the unique effects of spatial heterogeneity on these interactions. The work of beavers building a dam to flood an area is an example of activity that can change landscape structure. When it comes to humans, clearing a forest for agriculture can cause significant changes in landscape structure. A primary goal of landscape ecology is to understand the reciprocal relationship between spatial patterns and ecological processes. Understanding the mechanisms pertaining to flows of organisms, energy, and material is key. Spatial patterns refer to how we define the arrangement, structure, and placement of objects within a given landscape. This includes patches of forest, riverbanks, and human settlements like towns. Lastly, we must discuss the urban-rural gradient. As humanity has sprawled out in urban settings, there has invariably been a spread of cities' edges, which is increasingly difficult to delimit. Thus, a better understanding of urban-rural gradients is a key issue for urban planning. Rapid transformation is leading to landscape ambiguity. Where do we draw the line? And if we don't, what does all this encroachment mean for wild ecosystems surrounding urban spaces? We've already seen the impacts of this. In the mountainous terrain of Colorado, urban sprawl is leading to more and more wildlife interactions with predators like mountain lions and bears. Encroaching on habitats can lead to unintended consequences like the spread of disease and perhaps even the next pandemic. Exploring landscape pattern changes due to growth of human populations is important in order to maintain regional ecological security and to encourage sustainable development. Speaking of maintaining ecological security, what can we do to safeguard ecosystems from harm? Let's talk about conservation ecology next.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.